So a little overview of my talk. First, I'm gonna start off with a little introduction of myself for those of you who don't know me, and a little bit of background on myself, and then talk about a little bit of the history of Django with designers, and you know, just starting with that. And then speak to those of you who are in the crowd who are designers who have maybe, you know, looked at Django, decided this is for me, and want to start jumping in and learning more about it. And then move into what's new in Django 1.4 and follow up with a conclusionary statement on my talk. So first off, hi, I'm Julia Ellman. I am a designer, a front-end developer. I have 10 years of web experience in this industry, and I'm originally from the state of Kansas. Yes, yes, lots of you out there. So, but I recently made a big move to North Carolina and joined the Cactus Consulting Group and work with some of the most amazing developers this side of the Mississippi. So if you have any Django projects, questions, or training, or just anything, be more than happy to work with you on your projects or answer your questions. So I'd like to take a little trip back to 2007, where my journey to Django began. So in 2007, I accepted a position at Hallmark Cards Incorporated, located in Kansas City, Missouri, as a web developer. It was awesome. I got to work in probably one of the most creatively enriching environments that I've ever been in, and with lots of people from different creative backgrounds. Writers, illustrators, sculptors, all coming together to create a brand and an experience. So I accepted this position because I was working in this thing in my previous role, this awesome new technology, and I was really excited I was gonna be able to use it in my day-to-day work. And that thing, sorry, was Flash, right? Flash. Flash is awesome, right? So, you know, this was the time where you would actually, it was like choose your own adventure. Like, how many of you did those books? Yes, me, am I the only one? No, please, come on, yeah, everybody. So it was like choose your own adventure web experience. I go here for Flash, I go here for, you know, HTML, CSS. So I'm gonna choose Flash because it's awesome, right? Start using Flash. And we use Flash for pretty much everything. We use Flash in places that I knew you didn't have to use Flash. You use Flash in places that I knew you could just use JavaScript, HTML, and CSS to do the things that we wanted to do. So it began to become extremely frustrating and a really bad experience. So I was getting really frustrated, and I started talking to my coworker, like, I thought Flash is so cool, and now it's not so cool. So she said, why don't you come down to this conference with me? It's going to be great, meet lots of cool people. And that was South by Southwest Interactive in 2008. And that was also really awesome. Met a lot of interesting people while I was there. And one of those people was Simon Wilson, who is one of the founders of Django. And I told him about my frustrations and with, you know, Flash and where I lived, and he looked at me, and I remember he says, you live 30 minutes away from Lawrence, Kansas, and you're not doing Django? And I was like, what is this Django, you know? And for those of you who don't know, Lawrence, Kansas is the birthplace of where Django started, so that's the reference there. So I went back home, and I checked out the Django website, and the first thing I saw was the tagline, because I'm a designer and, you know, those things kind of matter. So I checked out the tagline, said, for perfectionists with deadlines. And there in itself was the thing that drew me in. So I was doing this thing that was really frustrating and took forever to get things done, and I wanted to do something that with rapid development and getting things done in a quick manner. So I decided to learn more about Django and reading more into it. And I was building my own applications and doing things myself as a designer, and it was very empowering and great. So in 2008, I accepted a position at World Online and as a junior designer developer. It was awesome. It was exciting and extremely challenging to be there. And every day was learning. I was learning something new every single day. I would walk out of there and know something new every single day. So I came out of there, I would say, I'm definitely more of a designer, but I came out of there with some developer experience because I was given the tools that I needed in order to do the things I wanted to do on my own. So in the middle, got the little hybrid, so. But is Django really meant for designers? So let's go back even further, right? Let's go back to 2005. Let's go to Chicago, because I love Chicago, and something happened there, and I don't know if any of you have watched this, and I highly recommend you do. It's the Snakes versus Rubies talk that's actually hosted on DjangoProject.com, and it was a series that was built based on the local Ruby users group in Chicago, and they invited Adrian Holovaty and DHH, the founder of Ruby on Rails, to come and give a talk on their frameworks and explain about their frameworks. And then at the end, they had a Q&A session. So in the Q&A session, it's almost exactly 30 minutes in, if you would like to watch that. So Adrian was asked very pointedly, what is the philosophy behind the Django templating? And what he stated was the person editing the templates doesn't necessarily need to be a programmer or know Python in order to do the templates, right? This in and of itself is empowering to people who maybe don't know programming, who are more into other things, but also want to start learning. So you don't need to start by reading a book this big or having any sort of computer science background or whatever. You can get started because Django is really helping you get started in that way because that's the theory behind it. Or the philosophy for the templating. So I would have to say that Django does love designers. And you can see that up until now, where you've got Idan Gazit as the benevolent designer for life. And you have somebody, yes, big round of applause, who could not be here with us today, so because he's got other things going on. He's around. But you've got Idan Gazit Encore, as well as other people with design experience on core working and making those decisions in the design for the design community for the Django community in design. So I'm a designer, right? People out here are asking yourself, where do I even start? Where do I even begin? I've drank the Kool-Aid, want to start using Django, where do I go from here? Here's a couple of recommendations. First of all, start with the tutorial. Now you're thinking to yourself, the tutorial, I'm not really doing applications. Well, I think any good designer knows that it's really important to understand how something works in order to actually to be a good at designing it. So that's very important. So start with the tutorial, and it's a rite of passage. Pretty much anybody here that's been doing Django for any amount of time has done the tutorial at some point. So do the tutorial. And once you're done with the tutorial, and maybe you have some questions, go to the documentation. It's there. The question's in there, and the answer to your question is in there, and you will find it. So start with the documentation. Let's say you can't find anything in the documentation, and you really want to talk to somebody. That's more the way that you learn, and you need someone to explain it to you. I recommend you going into Pound Django on Freenode and IRC. There's people answering questions all the time. A lot of us Cactus folks actually take a break and maybe answer a couple questions during the day, and you'll find some of us in there doing that. And it's also a really good way for you to learn, when you answer questions as well. And if you're more of the emailing type, try Django users' Google email group and post an email there and someone will answer it. Or you can search through there and possibly find an answer in a previous email, which is more than likely. So the next thing I recommend is somebody told me once that you should absolutely 100%, if you're doing any sort of Django templating, bookmark this link. And I want to reference that this is the development version for the template tags and filters for Django. If you're using other versions of Django, make sure that the DEV in there is actually 1.4 or whatever version you're using, but this is for the development version. But regardless, bookmark this link, whatever version you're using, just keep it on hand. You will reference it daily. It doesn't matter how long you've been doing Django templating, you will need this link. So seriously, bookmark it now. Just do it. So moving on to template tags and filters, I know everyone would love to have a session talking about every single template tag and filter that's available in Django, but we just don't have enough time. So I'm just gonna kind of overview on what tags are and filters are and move into my top three that I think you absolutely need to know by heart in order to start working in the templates. So tags, here's an example of a tag. So you can tell it's a tag, number one, is because of the percent signs. And this tag, actually, what it does is it's gonna say now, so right now, what year it is. So you're actually seeing what year. So this is actual tag that you can use. It's available to you in Django. It's something that most people use in pretty much every base template I could think of. So so this is actually a tag I would want to know. So those are tags. Filters are exactly what you think they are. So this is a filter right here. So filters are actually based on the context variables within your template. So you have an object, and that object has a publish date. You're going to the filter is the pipe in between the publish date and the date, and that's actually going to filter out the year that's actually in that publish date. So that's the difference between tags and filters. So let's start with my top three. So we're going to start with number three. Number one, if. Really important to know. So if is wonderful if you have something in the template. I'm saying if. If is wonderful if you have something in the template that you don't necessarily want to show if that variable is not available to you. So cats is a theme so far, I think, of most of the talks at DjangoCon, so let's just keep with that theme. So if cats are available to you, show that sentence, right? If it's not, it's not going to show up. So we need a fallback, really important, else. That's your fallback. So if cats, show the sentence. If there are no cats, that's really sad, and there are no cats. So, but it's good to have a fallback. Fallbacks are always good to have. So let's move on to number two. I bet you can't guess what this one is. So number two is for. So if and for are actually basic, from what I understand, are basic programming language concepts that are in most programming languages. So you've got conditional statements, and for is a loop. So for things like UL tags or, you know, so lists of things that you want to display for is a good thing to have or a good thing to know. So here you have for kitten and kittens. You're going to have lots of little kittens, hopefully. So that's going to actually output all the kittens that you have available within your kittens list that's available to you. So we go back to fallbacks, empty. So for kitten and kittens, if there are no kittens, again, that's really sad, you have no kittens, but you do have your fallback message to say that this is a very sad thing. So now, number one, can anyone guess what my number one is that you need to know? And those of you who know, don't answer. No one. Okay, so the number one that I think you need to know, and I feel is the most powerful, is extends. When used correctly, extends can actually be a very powerful thing to have. And, you know, I think it gets overlooked because extends is something that a lot of, you know, you have in most of your templates. It's just sort of automatic. Well, I'm extending from base. I'm extending from this. So, but when used right, you can develop templates in an extremely smart way. And here's the way that I use it. So you have your base template here. And in your base, you have an empty block. And I'm not going to get into blocks here because, like, I like to talk about everything, but we don't have time. So you have an empty block for your extra JS, right? So we don't like JavaScript to load on every single page. Some JavaScript, yes, maybe, but not on every single one. So you can actually, in your events, so let's say you have an events template, you're going to extend your base template, and you're going to fill that block with the JavaScript that's supposed to be used only for that page. That's awesome. You don't have to do it on every page and loading up the DOM, and yes, users, happy users are good users, and everyone's good. So I wanted to say one thing. So I think includes gets used wrong. sometimes. And I don't think that includes gets used in a way that needs to be used sometimes, where you can use extends. And just be smarter when you're building your templates. Really think them out, plan them ahead, and you know, don't use includes on everything, because that's messy and we don't like that. So what's new in Django 1.4? There's a lot of really awesome, new, cool stuff, but I'm only going to talk about a couple of things that are relevant to this talk. So first thing I want to talk about is the custom project templates. It's been brought up a lot. And I don't think, I'm not sure, but I don't feel like it's been a really, people really understand how awesome this is. So let's say you have a certain template that you're going to be using all the time for all the projects. So at Cactus, we have a project template, which I've posted a link here for our project template that we use for all of our projects. So you can say, you know, when you're creating your project, you can say, use this template to create my project, and you're done. So you're doing the same thing all the time. That just saves you so much time. So you have the same sort of base template. You have the same, you know, whatever. So use that, and you know, I think that actually helps everyone out, not just designers, but developers as well. So that's a really wonderful thing. HTML5 doc type in the admin, also a really great thing for people who are doing a lot of admin custom work. So being able to have all the HTML5 goodness, and it's valid. Yay, we like validation. So HTML5 doc type, thank you. Now there's another one that's kind of little, but I'm really glad is there. So is truncate cares. So before it was only truncate words, and this actually is gonna truncate your object, you know, the string of letters down to 12 characters. Before you could do words, there was a snippet that you could use for truncate cares, but now it's in Django, so thank you very much for making that happen. I'm very happy about that. So the next one, going back to our if statement, is elif, which is also a really great thing that is in there. So elif is so that you don't have to do something like this, right? So you have an if statement inside your else statement. So, you know, we shouldn't have to do that. I'm pretty sure you don't even have to do that in Python. So you don't have to do that in your templates. So this got put in 1.4, so you can do something like this. So that's clean code, so you don't have to, you know, you can actually pass in dog, and then you've got your dog sound, so instead. So, is Django's for designers or what, Julia? Just answer the question. My answer to that question? Sure. Honestly, I don't think Django's really for anybody specific. I think it's really for anybody who wants to create rapid applications or websites and likes to have fun when they code, because it's been a lot of fun for me in learning and the experience that I've had in using Django. So that is my answer. But I will say that there are a few blockers, I will say, in getting designers on board. Just a few blockers. Just a few things that are a little scary that kind of get in your way and you're not sure if you're gonna, you know, be able to move forward with it. And the first one, I think, is command line. Now, command line was something that I knew that I needed to learn and went into and started learning, but I think a lot of designers do not feel confident enough. They look at terminal window, they open it up, and they think, oh my gosh, I'm like Ally Sheedy and Matthew Broderick, and I'm gonna blow up, start Russia, like my computer plumes of smoke are just gonna come out, and you know, I'm not quite sure if I'm ready for that. So how do we solve that problem? Does it need to be solved? I'm not sure. I don't know the answer. The other thing is there's just too many things that you really need to know in order to get Django up and running. And I feel like it's come a long way since when I started with, I was talking to someone about path files. Does anybody remember path files? You had to use path files in order to. No one? Was I the only one? Oh no. So, you know, and you had to do that, but you have stuff like virtualenv and PIP that make it so much easier, and I'm very grateful for, but I still think there's just a few things that could definitely get cleaned up in that arena. So, Django, you know, why, Django needs more designers, and, you know, why should we make things easier? And the answer to that is, I feel like, pretty obvious, and it's been stated before, is that it's important to have designers because you can create this awesome application that does all this really cool stuff and this website that, oh my gosh, it's what? But I feel like without a designer's aesthetic and background, it's not gonna be as successful as it could be. Like, it might be successful, but it could be even more successful. And I think Django, the Django community really understands that. So what are some ways that you can get more designers involved? First one, share your brain. Share your knowledge, teach other people, tell them what you know. Even if you're tired and don't want to anymore, you know, but that's the next point I actually want to make, is be a mensch. For those of you who don't know Yiddish, being a mensch is being a person of integrity and honor. It means be nice. Going back to saying when you're too tired to answer a question in IRC or someone keeps bugging you, definitely be nice about it. Tell them I'm too tired, I'll answer it later, send me an email, but be nice. There's no need to be mean. And my Aunt Lane said so. The next thing that's really, really important to me is collaboration. And I want to reference a study that I found really interesting that was done in 2005 by Brian Uzi, who's a professor at the Kellogg School of Management at Northwestern University. And he published a study in Science Magazine about the mechanisms by which creative teams assemble. And the study involved about 2,200 Broadway musicals. And those productions that he studied ranged from 1887 to 1990. And what he found in that study is that the most successful collaborations came about when you had people from lots of different backgrounds, different experience levels coming together, working together, and creating something. And I found that very relevant to the success of Django. And I'd like to do a little audience poll, actually. And have those of you who have a computer science or an engineering degree, please raise your hand. And those of you who don't, raise your hand. I'd like those of you who don't, please shout out like what your major was in college.
Psychology.
Media
studies.
Literature.
Philosophy.
Philosophy, right. So printmaking, fine art and printmaking. The thing that you can see right here from this little audience poll that I just did, how diverse this community is, and how the collaboration and the backgrounds don't necessarily take a computer science major or somebody with that skill set to really create success. It's by bringing in people from all sorts of different backgrounds and different walks of life and different experience levels together to create a successful environment. Because the world's problems are getting much, much harder for us to solve, and we really need to start working together more and accepting more people in order to solve them. Thank you.
So we got some time for questions. I guess while we wait for, there we go, we got Jacob coming. Yeah, I was just about to point you out, buddy.
Well, I didn't see you there, Russ. I was going to say, since Russ isn't here, I guess I have to, but. So I wondered if you would go into a little more detail about the sort of the too many things, the sort of command line getting started type stuff. We have historically made some assumptions about what
right.
what a user of Django knows. I mean, we sort of dive right into, at your shell, type this. I mean, we don't say,
right.
this is a shell, this is how you find it. Do you think that we ought to be including those sort of basics, sort of what did Selena call it yesterday? Computational thinking, like sort of the basics of like, this is what a file system is, this is what a command line is. Should we be including that in our tutorial for people who need it? Is that somewhere where you see sort of the Django community helping those people, or is it a reasonable assumption that we pick up people at a certain point in their learning experience?
I think the problem lies in the fact of the interest in the person that's wanting to do it, wanting to learn command line, period.
Just even
you can say
even
this
just
is
caring.
How you do it, but I'll be honest, when I started using it, I'm like, I'm gonna break this thing.
Cool, thanks.
And I didn't, but yeah, that's what I'd say. Absolutely.
Hi. So you mentioned a couple of things about the Django templating system that you really like. What are the things as a designer that really bothers you about the Django templating system?
Ooh, that's a really good question that I really don't like. What I really don't like, it's more about how people use the templating system. And again, like I've had a lot of advice given to me over the years, and one of the best advice is that if it's too difficult to do in the template, it should be in a view. So I think the misuse of templates is the thing that probably bothers me the most. And not using extends where it needs to be, that's a huge pet peeve, where I see includes all over the place. I'm like, oh gosh, this reminds me of WordPress. So, you know, like, no, so, yeah.
Hi. Do you have suggestions for the best way for like a designer who's totally new to Django to learn it? Like, is it best to like pair off with the developer? Is it best to be mentored by like other designers who have gone through the same kind of thing? Is it like a solitary thing? You have to just kind of go home and like learn, go through the tutorial, that sort of thing?
I think it's really, 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 really hard to learn on your own in a silo, and that's for anybody learning anything. It's a pretty general statement. So I think, yes, absolutely, work with a developer and get help and ask questions and don't be afraid to ask them. Do not be afraid to sound stupid ever, because everyone does it sometime, and you will learn much, much faster. So yes, learn with other people. It's the only way I think you can learn, really. So thank you.
I guess it's almost flipping some of these questions around the other way. What would you like projects like Django or similar things to do to help avoid training more programmers to do things that drive designers up the wall? How not to use style sheets like a crazy person, that sort of thing, just so we don't make applications which need to be rewritten so they can get the look that we want. Is there anything we could do at the core level, at the documentation level, just to avoid those bad habits?
I think, I'm trying to understand the question. So I think that you should bring a designer in as soon as possible, maybe to avoid that. So you don't have, you know, a designer coming in later saying, oh, no, don't do it that way, do it this way. Bring them in sooner rather than later, not after the fact. So I don't know if that answers your question, though, exactly. But I can talk to you about it afterwards more.
Okay.
So yeah, let's do that.
So I think part of the success is of Django with design is that the template system isn't actively hostile to the collaboration of developers and designers, but also Jeff Croft working with the media team that originally created Django, he basically started evangelizing Django as for design, and that's actually how Brian Veloso heard about Django and got involved. And I think that basically just saying, hey, I've had some success with this kind of approach is a way to make the community more friendly, because basically you're not the only designer in it already. You know, you just look for the bright spots and follow the lead. So,
I think, like I said before, having Idan on board actually helps.
Sure.
And getting designers more involved and making it attractive to designers in a certain way, which I know there's a redesign for DjangoProject.com underway, so that's probably a good start. So, because I think a lot of designers will go to a website, and if it's, then they might move on. You know, that's a possibility. So, you know, I think maybe doing that. So,
So you had a question about, you know, logic and templates, and you talked a little bit about that in your talk, and you were mentioning sort of the rule of if it's too complicated to do in a template, you shouldn't do it in a template. We've had sort of this perennial long-running argument about how much logic should Django templates support. And we've had lots and lots of developer voices and people saying we should do more things or we should switch to Jinja or do all these things which allow more programming and templates. We haven't had a whole lot of designer voices in that discussion.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think we can do to hear from that sort of currently silent half of our community who's going to be really, really affected by any decisions we make?
Is there a list of these questions anywhere that people can ask? Has that question been posed to the community? So I think that, you know, asking that question to the community, posting it somewhere and saying, hey, we're working on this thing and wanting to make it better. What is everyone's input on it? It doesn't matter. You know, I think it was on, I forgot what board it was on, you know, there were all these people putting in, you know, different designs for DjangoProject.com, right? And there was all these things. I thought it was great. I thought it was awesome. And you just bring all these people and they just throw stuff up and then all these ideas coming together, because that's collaboration. And that's part of the creative process. So if you have a question like that, I think the best way to answer it is, I don't feel like I'm qualified enough to really answer up for everything, but I think that posting those questions up there and saying, create something like that, you know, and getting into the design community and also branching out and finding those new people, those new designers who are involved that are maybe here in the audience here today even, and asking them what they think coming in new. So, thank you.
So you're giving this talk to what I presume is predominantly a lot of developers. Are you going to be giving this talk at any design conferences to try to evangelize to people that might not necessarily think of Django?
You know, I haven't even thought of that yet.
Okay, you should.
Maybe I should. Maybe I should. So.
So something that you kind of touched on in the talk, I was curious to maybe elaborate a bit more on, is there, have you seen anything in the lines of tooling, aside from just like maybe documenting stuff better and providing a bit more of the computational literacy kind of stuff, from the perspective of a designer, have you had any thoughts on like, you know, if there were something X tooling-wise that doesn't exist currently?
Define tooling?
So managed.py shell or like that kind of stuff. Or
oh, you
even
should,
just
yeah,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, but I'm sorry, yeah, see? Exactly, problem. So an example of like a possible kind of thing that currently doesn't exist in the Django world, but like, I don't know if you ever heard of in the Rails world, PAL. PAL is basically this idea of, you know, it's a thing for OS X that, you know, it installs like a normal Mac app, and you basically just have a point at a directory, push a button, and your Rails app just runs. They
like,
figure out all
so
the weird Ruby stuff.
MAMP
they figure out
or
all, yeah,
like MAMP, right? Okay,
yeah.
So one click. I think somebody was talking about a one click Django install, and I understand that. That still kind of makes me sad because, you know, I say the command line's intimidating, but I also feel like if you're doing front-end web development and design, you need to be sort of pushed in that direction. You really need to start doing that stuff because stop using Photoshop. You don't need to use Photoshop. There's no reason to use Photoshop. You can totally do stuff, rapid prototyping, and there's tools out there to use it. So, you know, I feel like one-click install sort of, I understand that I'm kind of iffy on creating that.
Just a bit of follow-up on that. So it sounds like what might be useful is like instead of something like PAL where you just push a button, you have an app that hides all the magic or the details from you, stuff that can maybe ease the just goddamn annoying stuff, like, you know.
I understand.
You know, making, I don't know, maybe pill, installing pill on a vanilla
system. Did you say
pill
by any chance?
Yes.
Yeah. No, I understand.
So maybe that would be like a good area in that kind of vein to put energy on, or so then you're not isolating them from the path, but you're smoothing the like the first time experience of like, okay, I just want to try and use Django for the first time, but okay, now I'm instead learning how to fight with pill for 3 days. You know?
I've had that fight, so I understand that completely. But you don't necessarily have to have that fight anymore, kind of. But I mean, you could put a pretty, you know, GUI interface on virtualenv and pip and whatever and do something like that, sure, but I don't know, like, and maybe it's, I like, you know, why I got into this in the first place is, you know, I said I'm actually a printmaking major and I was talking to someone about this, so printmaking is, it's about process. Like, you have the final pretty product at the end, right, but it's all about, it's science, and it's all about process, so, I don't know. I'm on the fence about it. I understand that I feel like it needs to be done, but I don't know. That made me a little sad too.
Just to sort of speak to those points of, you know, onboarding designers that may not have any technical experience with installing Django or using pip, installing dependencies. We've had some really good success with using Vagrant, which might be conceptually even more difficult for people to understand.
Right.
But it's only two or three commands instead of 50. And it's only managing you know, a VirtualBox client instead of a virtualenv on your host machine. So you're really isolating, and it kind of removes some fear from the developer or designer that they're going to mess up their machine or something like that. So you can use tools like Vagrant and Fabric and file share or a shared folder to kind of isolate them but provide them an actual Django environment that they can, and they're only developing what they need to on their host machine in one directory, but they're still able to have all the functionality and see in real time what they're developing. And
I think the thing is so when I was working at World Online, you had a strict, like, designers do this and developers do this, and that twain shall not meet. And sometimes you do stuff, but it was like, no, that's developer land. But, you know, you got the choice to do it. Like, you could do it. I'm not sure a lot of developers actually did the templates, but that's kind of nice because you're separating sort of out, like, this is the stuff I like to do, and this is the stuff you like to do, and we're all doing it, you know, at the same time. And actually, the person that just came and asked a question is one of my coworkers, David, and created this comps app, which is on GitHub and is great because I can start designing and doing stuff, and he can start developing and doing stuff, and we can start at the same time. I don't have to wait on him, and he doesn't have to wait on me, and it's really fantastic, so definitely check it out. The other thing I want to say is I think there's actually a talk on Vagrant at the end of the day today by Julian Philippe, and I'm sorry if I did not pronounce that right, so, but I'm going to that, and you all should too.
You mentioned rapid prototyping.
Mm-hmm.
I was wondering if you design in HTML, if you found that it's fairly easy to design in Django, and what obstacles you face as a designer to doing that, let's say fixtures or things like that.
Mm-hmm. I haven't had too many obstacles when I'm doing rapid prototyping. Most of the time I'm doing my rapid prototyping, like I was saying, we kind of start at the same time, and maybe the developer doesn't have anything to give me yet. I have no context variables in order to do anything yet. So I'm just creating the raw HTML, CSS, JavaScript, whatever to begin with, and then can plop those things in later.
You're doing that in Django, though?
Well, yes, because the way that, like, what we do at Cactus, the way it works is that we actually have, like, a comps folder, and I can create all these different HTML files, so, but only a few, because we have a sort of a set process that we're doing where we start out with different phases of developments for clients. So we have, like, the prototyping phase and the design phase and all that stuff. But I think getting out of Photoshop is, if you're a designer and doing web stuff, getting out of Photoshop is probably one of the most wonderful things. I had so much fun. I was just like, oh my gosh, I don't think about layers and having to organize everything. And we were able to create things like this. So, well, maybe not like that, but you know.
And since you brought it up, and there seems to be some time still, I did create a simple app. We had one client that they had a designer that was totally foreign to Django templating, anything Django, but he really wanted to be involved in the project, so we had to figure out a way to, you know, how do we incorporate him into our workflow and not have him screw everything up, right, from the developer perspective? How do we let him to learn about templating and things like that if he doesn't have the internal motivation to instantiate Django on his machine or have sysadmins to help him set up an environment? I developed this Django comps app, which just simply defines a directory where he can plop, you know, normal HTML and CSS, but it's rendered by the run server, so you still have all the power of the templating tags and filters, so he can sort of learn on his own. doesn't require us to define views for him. He can just say, this is the list of blog posts.html, and it'll render, you know, a table of contents for him. He can click them and view them on his own Vagrant machine that we set up for him. It works really well, and like Julia said, she started using it for prototyping on other projects, so I was kind of glad to see it has more than one use case.
And I will say that that designer that he's referring to, his name is Les James. He's a wonderful designer, but doesn't have a lot of technical experience, and I saw him at a meetup a couple weeks after he started using Django, and he was so incredibly excited and loved it, and he was coming from a WordPress world. So there in and of itself, the interest is there, just how do we get more designers? So thank you.
Cool. Thank you very much.